So take me down to the river with my blood all on the floor. 'Cause I don't know if I can carry this weight much longer anymore. Take me up the mountain on a cloud bound for the sky. Don't go praying for me, because tonight I'm prepared to die.
Welcome to Cowboy Shit, this episode number 101, the next 100. Thanks for listening for this 100. Kobe, go ahead.
He drinking already?
No, he's just got a Diet Coke.
Oh.
I got to talk to Mike.
We already had to redo this one. Anyways, episode 101. I'm Ted. He's Wacey. Our friend Kobe Moore, the one and only Western sports photographer in the hotel room this morning. Just wrapped up Grand Prairie last night. We're about to head home, but got her going. Wacey, let's talk about our sponsors.
Before we get into things, we got to thank our friends from Circle 4 Beverage Company, Southern Ranch Water and Sweetwater. They've been with us now for a few months, so they're pretty awesome. It still seems like a bit of summer left. The weather's been so good, so it's a good time to enjoy Sweetwater or in Ranch Water at the same time. And secondly, our other friends from Manscaped. Support for Cowboy Shit is brought to you by Manscaped, who is the best in men's below the waist grooming. Manscaped offers precision engineered tools for your family jewels to keep your pumpkins fresh during this cuffing season. Manscaped just launched their fourth generation trimmer, the Lawnmower 4.0. Ted and I both have these. They're fucking awesome. My nuts have never been cleaner. Well, like, they've never looked better, I don't think. Just less hair. I know cleaner isn't the word.
Cleaner isn't the word.
But yeah, anyways, the 4.0. Join 2 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped with this exclusive offer from us to you. 20% off, free worldwide shipping with code HUGEBUSH at manscaped.com. Go get one. You'll love it. We love it. Can't go wrong.
Great people. Huge bush.
I know you're for those guys with an old lady around this winter season. I know she'd probably appreciate a little bit of Manscaped in her life. During those cold winter months.
More action.
Less push equals more action. And you know what? Presentation wise, less bush helps some lads out, if you know what I mean.
If you trim the bush, the trees look bigger.
Exactly. That's exactly what I'm trying to say. Yeah.
Hey man, that's all true.
I need all the help I can get. So I feel that.
Well, Wacey, we just wrapped up Grand Prairie here. We had a heck of a way to write it. Like there's been a couple of those this year. Jake Gardner wins in Grand Prairie, his basically home crowd of lots of friends and family around from
good to see him back in Canada too.
Yeah, exactly. So we, you know, spent a lot of time in the PRCA rodeos getting some qualifications up to really get going again next year. But yeah, couldn't really script it any better. He's only got to go 3 for 3 this weekend. That was neat. But you know, talking about those hometown crowds, we had Tanner, you know, winning Coronation. That was like his first PBR win, and he won in his hometown. That was a neat one. But go ahead, Coach.
Well, last night was Jake's first tour win for.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's never done one of those before.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Came up to me after and just said 3 years of trying on these things and finally got one. And he said it must have had something to do with the home crowd, the homish crowd. I mean, in 2021, it's going to be his home show. So,
yeah, I like it. So
Jake's been riding good this summer too. You've seen a lot of videos from down the States making some good rides. So it's good to 100%. See him come home and, do some damage.
But so we just wrapped up Grand Prairie. We got, what else? We got Medicine Hat coming up on the 16th, Calgary, the 23rd, Saskatoon, the 29th, the 30th. Then the PBR moves to Yorkton, on the weekend of the CFR. And then we finish up in Edmonton, Rogers Place, November 12th and 13th. Tickets on sale for all tour stops now. Check it out. But Wacey, you got a little black under your eyes there.
Is that a black eye?
Okay, before we get into this, I want to say thank you to the people for 200,000 downloads. That's huge.
We hit that
over the past week. So that's really cool for us. We appreciate the support and people listening to what we have to say for whatever reason. So we really appreciate that. That's awesome.
It's kind of funny. Sean made us those, but made me a really cool little plaque that he 3D printed, and it said 200,000 downloads, 100 episodes, September 2021. And I was giving him trouble because I was like, I don't know, Sean, I don't know if we're gonna make that by the end of September. And then we hit the 200,000 on October 1st.
Oh
And I was sending him, updates on like on the night of the 30th, and I was like, ah, we can just round up. I think we're close enough. So
is that a count your chickens situation right there?
Yeah, a little bit.
So it's like getting like a your team's like championship tattoo, like before the team actually wins,
like
the championship.
In game six.
Yeah,
it was like it's like ooh yeah. But anyways, I appreciate the, cool. the gesture, Sean. Yeah, and it's a pretty cool piece to have kicking around now. So. Yeah, I guess what's the next milestone? I guess 300,000.
300K. 300K. Let's keep growing. Let's keep growing this thing. Keep sharing some stories.
By that time, that guy will have like metal 3D printing figured out. He's having a lot of fun with that.
I get a plaque for it for sure.
Okay,
that's cool.
Black guys, let's go. Spill the beans.
Okay. Well, I had a big sports weekend. Started off Friday with the Flames versus Canucks preseason game. I went with my friend Josh and his father-in-law. So as we're walking to the game, Josh's father-in-law pulls out a couple of spicy darts. He's like, hey, my Paige's boyfriend gave these to me. You guys want to smoke one before we go to the game? And we're like,
you said a spicy dart? Does that mean
some electric lettuce was involved in this?
Like a doobie.
Yes, it's a joint. It's a joint.
So I think the legal definition is cannabis in Canada.
Yeah.
Sorry, anyways, just throw that out there.
I like calling them spicy darts because they get me feeling spicy. Anyways, we're walking to the game, like from my place to the dome, smoke the spicy darts, and we're like, all three of us are just cooked by the time we get to the game. It's so wild. So we end up getting cranked up. I had a way wilder Friday night than I expected. So then also the Rough Riders were in town. So a bunch of like 14 of us got tickets to the game. So yesterday we got our acts together, got rid of the hangovers that we need to get rid of, and then went down to Pazzer, Saskatchewan pub for a pregame before the game. And then one of the people we were with had some face tattoos. So naturally I put some face tattoos on because I love the Riders from Saskatchewan, love the Riders. And then we went over to the football game and watched it. But, man, it's crazy how shitty Stamps fans are. Like, they're not good fans. It's a shitty stadium and shitty fans. Like, there's no noise. Like, they're just like, everybody's just so like, meh. But there's no energy at all. Like, when I went to the Rider game in Regina, for the Labor Day Classic, there was 30,000 people there. Like going, but you could feel the energy and like how excited people were, and the people were actually cheering. There's actually some enthusiasm behind it. Like, and we sat like in the lower sections of McMahon, and it was just completely dead. Like nothing. Like no fun.
I think Calgary Stamps fans specifically, or the Stamps itself, is like a organization
trash organization.
They're an amazing team and an amazing organization, but they're just at that stale point. The Stamps have done a lot in the league for a long time and have kind of created an expectation out of Calgary fans. I'm a Calgary fan, and I'll admit we can be the worst. Absolutely. No question. We're the like close-minded sporting fans, in my opinion. You bring up another team and it's just like, man, the Flickers, you know, instead. Yeah. So yeah. I just think there's so much expectation out of Calgary fans at McMahon there. And then just, you know, Mosaic?
It's Mosaic.
Yeah, so
field,
Mosaic,
yeah.
Beautiful, only a couple of years old. Huge excitement surrounding that deal. What do we got, man? We've got constant argument between city councils and 3P partnerships to build new stuff for our sporting team. So it is a mess situation. So as long as they weren't treating you shitty,
were kind of being kind of lame. But anyways, Riders lost. That's not a big deal. But did you guys know, here's a fun fact. I read an article the other day that the Rough Riders are the second most profitable franchise in Canada behind the Habs.
I think we might have talked about that. Yeah. I think that was another conversation, but
it's pretty cool though. It's pretty neat that like a small CFL team in Saskatchewan.
I'm surprised it's not the Leafs though. Just surprised.
Montreal,
I'm just surprised.
Man.
Yeah.
Montreal, man. They love it.
What other useless stats do you have about the Riders that you could share with us? Go ahead.
How busy was Pazzer's?
Pazzer's was not busy, actually. We're pretty disappointed. We showed up there. It was sweet. I like that bar. You've been there, Teddy. It's a good spot. They got good, like, Sasky, traditional Sasky, like, plates.
Like
that you find
Regina
in most bars.
Ribs.
Regina ribs, yeah, man. Whatever. It just, like, vibes of, like, a small-town bar at home. Like, it reminds me of the bar I grew up going to, all that kind of stuff. But
back when you were
any
young lad,
useless folks, Rider facts? Man, I don't really know many. I was at the Grey Cup, and did I tell you guys what the time when I was at the Grey Cup in 2013 when they won?
With the Sheepdogs, yes.
Yeah, that was the greatest sporting event of my life. Yes. I bought the ticket at 11 a.m. the day of the game.
So far.
Yeah. So far. It was awesome. It was to watch the Riders win at home. The 50-50 was 350,000, I think.
That's pretty good.
And it went unclaimed. It went unclaimed. Fun fact.
Damn. Yeah. So we got to talk about, man, we got to talk about Newfoundland.
Man, there's been lots of stuff on the past week. Man, Newfoundland was legit the wildest week of my life.
so like far.
Bar none. So far.
So to lead in, these two gentlemen spent about a week each in Newfoundland for their good friend Preston Sears' nuptials and got up
tighten to no ups. Good.
Became Newfoundlanders? Is that?
Yeah, we got screeched in.
Screeched in. There's got to be more to this.
Look at this.
Screechers.
Yeah, Uncle Patrick.
Newfoundlander. Uncle Pat.
Officially
screeched
in by Uncle Patrick.
So when you visit Newfoundland, they have this thing called screech, and they have a screeching in ceremony. So basically, screech is just shitty spice rum. It's the way I understood the story from Uncle Patrick. But anyway, so the process, you have to eat a piece of Newfoundland steak, which is just bologna. And then you have to eat a little candy that's like, I think it's like a mint, they call it nubs or nibs or something. And then you have to do a shot of screech. And then you have to recite a sentence in like a Newfoundland accent. And then you have to kiss a codfish.
Do you remember what the line was?
I think
are you not allowed to say it? Is it like part of the screeching that
fight,
you can't?
I don't know. Club. There's nothing here that says you can't do it.
You can't.
He's checking the legalities towards what he can do.
Man, I'm gonna hang this by my degree. This thing's fucking sweet. I'm an honorary Newfoundlander. I had so much fun in Newfoundland, man. It was great.
I forget what it was, but it was something.
It's like so the guy asks you, it's like yeah, it's like
cock is an old friend, apparently.
Is you a screecher? Yes, I is, me old cock. And may your long, or I can't remember the last part
of
that.
Long may your big jib draw.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's basically like supposed to make you say like cock and jig and a bunch of stupid
jib,
shit.
And big yeah. jib. Yeah.
Throb.
It's pretty good. But yeah. Everybody fucks it up at least three times.
But then Uncle Patrick explained where that part came from. It's because a lot of the people who came to Newfoundland came from Cockney. And that's how you'd refer to like someone from Cockney, like you're an old cock. But man, Newfoundland's crazy. They have crazy names for everything. Like they have dildo. They have Conception Bay. They have Cuckold Cove. I saw that on one of the maps.
Did you say Cuckold Cove?
Yeah,
they legit have one. Like it's just it's just north of like St. John's. It's crazy.
Is it like the cove that just gets to sit and watch? Or
I have no idea. Apparently, like one of the guys said, it's like, well, these were all named before people knew what they were, and I was like, yeah, right, dude. The people naming this shit, like they knew.
They're fucking with you from the past.
Yeah, no shit. But it was cool, man. We got to stay right in the St. John's Harbor, so we got to see the Navy was in town for a couple days. Got to see a submarine coming in.
We have a military.
I think we saw the entirety of the Canadian Navy was in St. John's. We were there. There was one supply ship, two battleships, and a submarine. That's the Canadian Navy right there.
It was all there.
We like to partner with people.
Saw all of it.
It's okay to be small.
But that was really cool to see. We went to the furthest most east point of North America called Cape Spear, just kind of just east of St. John's. And we went there during the tropical storm. So it was like 80 to 90 kilometer an hour winds and like constantly. Like
Did it blow you over? Did you feel like
it's crazy, dude. Like you think that you know wind living in like southern Alberta. Like we get like Chinooks and like Lethbridge is windy as fuck, but like you have no idea what wind is until you've experienced like off the sea like that. It's crazy. It's like it was luckily blowing us the right way, so we didn't get blown off the cliff, but yeah, it's pretty cool to see like there's like 20-30 foot waves. So seeing the ocean angry was really neat. But for the most part, the weather was great. Like the whole time we were there, like never had any shitty weather. The partying is insane. Like both bars last calls at the last call at Preston's wedding was 2:45 a.m. So like it's just a whole nother planet out there when it comes to partying, dude.
So which one wins then for geographical traditions? Getting screeched in Newfoundland or getting laid in Hawaii?
Getting screeched in Newfoundland.
Have you been to Hawaii yet?
Never been to Hawaii, but I Newfoundland is just a good. I fit in really well with the people in Newfoundland. They're my kind of people.
When are you going back? And are you in love?
Yeah, did you find a lady love on the trip?
No. I made a friend along the way, but I wouldn't call it love. Yeah,
a friend.
Okay.
That's all I'm gonna say, boys. That's all I'm gonna say.
Will she be on the upcoming episode of The Bachelor?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
Do we need to zoom her in?
I forgot about that. That I agreed to that.
You did.
Wasn't there a deadline? Wasn't there some sort of like if I don't have something?
If I'm not dating somebody, like basically come January or end of January, I gotta do it again.
I dig it.
October,
all right.
November, December. It's a three-month waste.
I don't have much time, boys.
Would we be bad friends to Wacey or good friends to the podcast if we cock-blocked him for the next 3.5 months?
Oh, I don't want to be that guy.
No, that's anything.
I mean, and like, I don't foresee myself dating somebody that like in the next, I just, cause there's like, no, I don't have any prospect. I don't like, I'm not really like seriously seeing anybody. And I'm so busy that searching for a girlfriend in this economy is just not, it's not, it's a hard thing to do.
I love the economy comment. That's cool.
In this economy.
I gotta say anyways. Too, Storm and I had a great time in Newfoundland. We saw a lot of neat stuff.
Went man, over to yeah, Gross you guys
Moore.
Did.
Yeah. We made a lot of miles. We went over to Gross Moore and went over to, Leanne Meadows, I think somewhere like way up north by like St. Anthony. It's like the furthest north
in Newfoundland.
Yeah, furthest northwest point in Newfoundland. It was like a 12-hour drive from St. John's. Whatever. There was like there's a Viking settlement there from like 1,000 years ago.
That's the first. That's like the first con. The first contact.
Yeah, yeah. One of the first from the from. Yeah, it's pretty neat. It was neat.
That's so cool. That's cool stuff.
Beautiful. Yeah,
you can see the mantle of the Earth in Gross Moore.
Yeah, yeah, the mantle.
The mantle.
We walked all through. It looks like Mars. It was
kind of cool. Yeah, that's
yeah. Sweet. And we had some really nice meals in a couple fishing villages. There was one over there that was like I think it was called Trout River, and I had halibut cheeks, and I thought that they were supposed to be better than they were. They were real stringy. I don't know if they were supposed to be like that, if they cooked them wrong, or what
I had cod tongue.
Isn't the cheek supposed to be delicacy?
It's supposed to be really good, but it was really stringy. So I don't know if they cooked it really wrong popular. Or if it wasn't right. But the best meal we had out there, there was one at there was this Nettie's Harbor Inn. They had a Black Spruce restaurant upstairs, and they had breakfast. We had like I had like sourdough pancakes for breakfast 2 mornings there. It was awesome. Then we had a really nice Alberta beefsteak the one night actually. Storm got I had to ask him because we were in Newfoundland. I was like, where do you get your beef from? They're like, oh, it's Alberta beef. He was all pumped about it. And I was like, fuck yeah, I'll take a steak out here then. Sure. Trying to have some nice meals and take
the food was good. The food was good over there, man. It was awesome.
The best meal we had was fried cod, like pan fried cod, like way up in by St. Anthony. That was the best meal I had. We're up there, I think. Circle, if you look like you're thinking.
Fish.
There's did I tell you guys about the one? So we went to this one brewery called Kitty Vitty, which is a little like kind of a little like trendy area of St. John's, like a little like fishing inlet. And they have this beer, it's called Iceberg, and they get it. There's only one guy in the world who's licensed to harvest like iceberg ice. So he goes out during iceberg season, harvests a bunch of ice water and brings it back to this brewery, and they make a beer with it. And like the water's so pure from the icebergs, they have to add stuff to it. So like the beer like sticks to whatever, like it's like, there's like, it's parts per million of like minerals in it is so low. They have to add minerals to it for like the beer to actually get made. But man, it is one of the best beers I've ever had. They call an iceberg beer from Kitty Vitty. It comes in a blue bottle. It is so like fresh. It's awesome. I drank a ton of those while we were over there.
Iceberg is this iceberg hunting stuff is new to me. That sounds like I want to meet this guy.
Yeah, it's literally just like one guy from St. John's who's like, and it's like 20,000-year-old ice that they're getting.
Is he just like mad extreme? Like, you know, those we've seen those photos of like Newfoundland towns when there's a friggin' like skyscraper sized iceberg just rolling past the towns out there. So like, does this guy just get real excited? Like,
I think he has like
swim out, like climb on it, chip some shit. Like, what's the?
He has a boat with like I think it has like some kind of like arm on it that he can like just like break off chunks of ice and then
so put
it
cool. on.
Yeah, it's pretty neat. Yeah,
holy.
So that's part of the story. We even went to Kitty Vitty, which was awesome. So that was a cool highlight. The history there is so neat in St. John's, like because they didn't join Confederation in Canada until 1949, but there had been people there since like the mid 1800s. Like they've been like an independent nation for so long. And it was pretty cool. That
too, when you count the
Vikings.
Yeah, well, and the Native American population as well. Yeah. People that lived there.
The Inuit people. Too. Yeah, there's so many people. Yeah, right. Yeah, it's pretty cool. It was really neat.
We better wrap up the first half. Anything else, we'll call it good.
No, if you ever get a chance, go to Newfoundland.
Check it out.
It's a great spot.
Who's your interview today?
Keith Ryan Cartwright.
Oh,
yeah.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, coming up next. Keith
Ryan Cartwright. And confirm, he is a Nickelback fan.
This is episode 101, Cowboy Shit with Ted and Wacey. I'm Ted, he's Wacey. Our friend Kobe Moore joining us today. We'll be back with Keith Ryan Cartwright after this.
They blew up the chicken man in Philly last night, and they blew up his house too. Down on the boardwalk, they're ready for a fight. Gonna see what them racket boys can do. Now there's trouble busting in from out of state, and the DA can't get no relief. Gonna be a rumble on the promenade, and the gambling commissioner's hanging on by the skin of his teeth. killer thing dies, baby, that's a fact. But maybe everything that dies someday comes back. Put your makeup on, fix your hair up pretty, and meet me tonight in Atlantic City.
Welcome back to Cowboy Shit. This is episode 101, our first of the next 100. And we have our guest for the show on the line. He's the former editorial director and senior writer for the PBR. Renaissance man, some might say. He's wrote about rock and roll. He was a movie critic, a entertainment writer, and he's the author of a new book, The Black Cowboys of Rodeo, Unsung Heroes, From Harlem to Hollywood in the American West. Coming to us from just outside Nashville, Tennessee, my friend Keith Ryan Cartwright, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Hey, so I was looking at your bio here, and you've interviewed three different whites: Betty White, Jack White, and Mike White, and the White Stripes. So four, you could say. That's quite a interesting set. You've got entertainment, music, bull riding, and another. And another band. I thought that was kind of funny, from three folks with a different last name, White. You've interviewed a lot of interesting folks in your travels.
Yeah. I you know, a couple of those are pretty interesting. Real quick, the first time I ever interviewed Mike White, I was brand new. I wasn't overly familiar with people, especially on site, you know. And so the first time I interviewed Mike, rather than just say Mike and leave it at that, I slipped and I referred to him as Mike Lee.
Ooh. You wouldn't like that either.
Yeah, that was, listeners who are familiar with the PBR will get the humor in that. But yeah, I called him Mike Lee the first time, but Mike White and I got along great. He was a great interview. I don't know. So Betty White was interesting as well. I was writing and producing television shows, and at the time we were doing a lot of the countdown shows for CMT. So 20 sexy Southern men, 20 sexy Southern women, 20 sexy videos, 20 greatest moments of Shania Twain, 20 greatest moments of Hank Williams Jr. Like I could count to 20. Okay. I absolutely can count to 20. And, but we were shooting one of those shows. I don't remember which one. And another producer called up. They knew we were going to be in LA shooting interviews, and they were working on a countdown of, comedies that would appeal to the country, the CMT country audience. And Betty White was coming in. They needed to get an interview with her. And they knew I was going to be set up doing interviews. And they said, would you mind interviewing Betty White? I said, absolutely. And so Betty comes, and we had a green room next to a room that we shot in, and they're just hotel rooms at the Roosevelt Hotel on Hollywood Boulevard in Hollywood. And she's in the green room. She's very friendly, and her and I go to walk next door to the next room where we're going to do the interview. And as soon as we get in the door, she stopped, and she kind of had her hand on my shoulder, and she said, "Oh, you've never filmed an old lady before." And I said, "Excuse me?" And she goes, "Do you know how I know you've never filmed an old lady before?" And I said, "What?"
No idea.
I'm thinking like some kind of humor is going to come out. And she said, "Look at where you got that fill light pointed." She said, "You got the lights all fucked up for an old person like me." She said, "You turn that floodlight on, it's going to shoot from behind my head through my hair and make me look like fucking bald." And then she just walked across the room and started moving all the lights around and said, This is how I like my lights."
Oh, wow. That's pretty damn cool.
She knows.
That's a light story.
Oh, dang. Okay, then it's Jack White. And wasn't Jack White?
Jack White's part of the White Stripes. It's him and his sister.
Is he?
Yeah, it's him and his sister.
Okay. Oh, that's right. But yeah. he was another band too, wasn't he?
The Raconteurs. They only had I think they're one hit wonder.
Okay.
They kind of were.
Yeah.
So, Jack, I interviewed him because this was before Jack produced the album with Loretta Lynn. There's two stories in the Tennessean in when I was writing for them about music, and I never really wrote much about country music for the Tennessean. They knew I was an LA guy, and so I was I wrote more rock and roll, and I guess Jack was rock and roll, you know. So that was somehow how I got. Well, actually, the Jack White story was for a CMT magazine, and for the Tennessean, I wrote a Kid Rock story, and I was the first person to ever write about the friendship between Kid Rock and Hank Williams Jr. And then a couple of a year or so later, I was the first person, well before Jack produced the record. It's actually what led to the record. I wrote a whole story for CMT magazine about how one of Jack White's favorite female singers is Loretta Lynn. And then her manager saw that article, and things just kind of happened from there. And that's what led to him producing the Loretta Lynn record. And so that's my Jack story.
Jack White.
He had actually made a movie. He had made a movie, but we never talked about it. Not one minute of the, you know, he got on the phone, and then he knew I was writing for the Tennessean and CMT and that I was in Nashville, and all he wanted to tell me about was how much he liked country music and how much he hoped to live and work in Nashville one day, in which over the next few years after that, it kind of happened.
Wait, so tell me then where he ended up. Because I thought he was always one of the most badass guitar players around.
Yeah.
And now he's in the country music side of things.
Well, I mean, he's a record producer as well. He lives in Nashville. So writes and produces a lot of music for a lot of people. And I think he lives in East Nashville. And when he first came to town, he had a studio not far from my house. So, yeah, he's like the Raconteur band that Wacey mentioned earlier. Those guys all kind of came together in Nashville. Nashville, you know, it is the country music capital, correct? You know, there's no doubt about it. But people forget the actual nickname is Music City, USA, not Country Music City, USA. It's Music City, USA. So Nashville's where Dylan went electric. Nashville's where Matchbox 20 recorded all their albums, you know, at Ocean Way. Down on Music Row. I mean, the Kid Rock records are there. Even though he's all about the D, Detroit, he was influenced and inspired by Nashville. The Beatles. Now, this isn't really Nashville, but they loved Nashville. the Beatles were inspired by Buck Owens. That's more Bakersfield, California. Oh, sure. But, you know, who would have thought when you listen to the Beatles music that some of those guitar riffs that they have, it prior to them writing those, they're listening to Buck Owens.
Dang. Okay, I got a question. You can take it however you'd like to. But who did you like interviewing more, Alice Cooper or Tuff Cooper?
yeah.
Okay, that's gonna be my guess.
I don't know. I know that. I'm just gonna venture a guess that Tuff Cooper probably doesn't give a shit about our podcast. But I feel like that guy is full of shit sometimes. Just gonna lay it out there.
I don't know him well enough. I'm not dodging the question. I don't know him well enough. I know that there's no middle ground. I think
Okay.
I mean, people are either in his camp, or I don't have any reason not to be in the camp. I honestly, I only have a vague recollection of
talking to him,
of the interview. I don't remember what I wrote. I don't remember why I spoke
wasn't
to him,
memorable.
But I knew I spoke to him.
Okay.
Strange deal.
Okay. What about Alice Cooper now?
To wake up. I know. I remember that.
You had to wait for him to wake up.
Yeah, he was. The interview was set for whatever time. They said he usually sleeps in, but he was still sleeping, so I had to call back. And
like, oh wow,
nappy time, night night time.
What a little baby. Okay. Oh, anyways, Alice Cooper, not a baby. Probably a pretty sweet conversation.
Yeah. We talked about golf. We talked about how just his staying power, how even his genre of music has kind of waned, and yet he's found a way to always remain sort of relevant, you know. Like I guess if you are fortunate enough to reach some sort of legendary status, you can sort of ride those waves and you know, not really fall down in the valley off the wave.
That's a
dumb analogy, but you know what I mean.
I get it. I have so many questions about this list of these different interviews. Like, Keith has this insane list of people he's talked to. Like, just couple names.
I have three questions in regards to this.
To this list? Okay, but I'm just going to mention a few. Wayne Gretzky, Garth Brooks. The only one that we've had on the show so far is Larry the Cable Guy. You've got Dan Rather, Jerry Reed. I remember seeing a lot about a big piece you did with Sally Field. What do I got here? Kevin Bacon, Kevin Costner.
Tommy Chong.
Yeah. Canadian band Emerson Drive. I can't read my own writing here now. Terry Bradshaw. Yeah. But holy shit, Trevor Brazil, Ty Murray. I think it's kind of crazy, but I got a couple things, but let's go back. Let's go to Wacey first here. What do you?
All right. When it comes to the music side of things, like, who has been your favorite interview from that list so far?
It's really hard to say just a favorite. I know that, you know, Ted mentioned Sally Field, and when you get done interviewing Sally Field and she says she's going to remember I'm going to remember our conversation, because great journalists are rare and great conversations are rare. And you're one of those. That's not exactly how she said it. Pretty close. That kind of stays with you. Interviewing Hank Jr. and having him talk about the broken relationship he had with his kids, most notably Hank the Third, and have him tear up and cry during the conversation. I mean, that obviously stands out. It's
powerful stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, this really probably is out of your purview or what have you, but Ronnie James Dio for the band Dio, you know, back when there was Black Sabbath and Iron Maiden and all, and Dio and all those, you know, so here's Ronnie James Dio. And my tape recorder, it wasn't a digital recorder. It had a little, it held a little cassette, but it was handheld. And it died in the middle of the interview.
No.
And he said, do you need batteries? I said, it can't be the batteries. I put, at the beginning of an interview, I would always put brand new batteries in, because I never wanted that to happen. It stopped. And he had a bag with him, and in that bag was a little mini toolkit. And here's Ronnie James Dio. We stopped the interview, and he got a screwdriver out and he's taking apart my digital recorder. And I said, wow, are you sure we're going to get this back together? And he said, you know, dude, I take apart and build musical equipment every day. He said, I think I can handle it. and then lo and behold, he got the tape recorder working.
Nice.
No way.
So little things like that stand out. I mean, going to South Dakota with Kevin Costner and interviewing him at Tatanka, which is where the land where they filmed Dances with Wolves, and talking to him about the history of the buffalo and what attracts him to, you know, the Badlands and Deadwood and all that. I mean, that was pretty, I don't know. It's just, there's been moments that have been that kind of just stand out that I don't know about a favorite per se. That when we get done, there's going to be one that pops out. I mean, I interviewed former President Jimmy Carter, and I remember right next to me, I had a big piece of paper that I typed in humongous bold lettering, Mr. President, because I wanted to remind myself that no matter if you're able to make it conversational, never not call him Mr. President. And so it was my first time interviewing a president. It was over the phone. He couldn't see it. And I didn't know how long or how short the conversation was going to be, because he was in Philadelphia. He had a speaking engagement. It was a Friday afternoon. And they said the traffic will be very bad. And there is a little bit of distance between where he was speaking and where the airport was. And they said, basically, once we get in the car, his assistant will call you and hand him the phone. And you have full reign to talk to the president until we get to the airport and he has to get out of the car. And then, you know, but like I say, I had no idea what the traffic would be like, but you know, interviewed him and I needed it was one of those times where I needed a reminder, because I didn't want to have another Mike White, Mike Lee kind of
thing. Not with a former president.
Learned a lesson.
No.
Do you have like a bucket list of people you want to talk to? Like some big fish you haven't had a chance that are just the ones you want to get?
I mean,
aside from us.
Well, man, the big check mark is off tonight. Well, this isn't going to seem all that impressive to a lot of people, but I love history, and I don't really consider myself a journalist. I'm a storyteller. And whether I'm writing for a magazine, a newspaper, a web site, or writing a television show, or helping out on a documentary, you know, whatever project I'm writing on, it's about storytelling. And so to me, two storytellers that I haven't met, Ken Burns, the great documentary filmmaker, and Ron Howard, another great filmmaker who has now gotten into doing documentaries almost as much as the big blockbuster movies. And so I've not met or spoken to either of them, and I, you know, I hope to.
What brought on the conversation with Wayne Gretzky? I gotta ask that.
He was at the PBR World Finals in 2008 or 2009. That was not the most friendly, but he was at the finals.
Oh, okay.
And he was there way early during the day. Randy Bernard is good friends with him, and at one point, that's right, Wayne and John Elway, they had bought into
Spire, wasn't it? They were part owners.
Spire Capital.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so they were, you're not embellishing, but it is a little bit of an embellishment to say they were part owner. I mean, they were a fraction of an owner.
Oh, of the company that owned it.
Yeah.
Okay.
They were one of many, 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 many investors in the
Spire. Okay. Spire. What about Jerry Reed? I that name popped out to me.
Let me tell you. What a So for those who don't know, he's an incredible guitar player, incredible songwriter. He's one of the greatest guitar players of all time, bar none, end of story. But he also played in Smokey and the Bandit, you know? So anyway, I did a piece for Country Weekly, which was a glossy magazine you could buy in the grocery stores near the cash wrap for many, many years. I don't think it exists anymore. Not as a magazine anyways. And I was writing an article for them, and him and I met in Brentwood, right outside of Nashville, at a restaurant. And we spent the whole afternoon together just talking. And I really admired him. And it wasn't too long after that he had passed away. And we had a great time. He was wearing a hat. And I knew before I said this, that he's an Atlanta Braves fan. He loves baseball. I love baseball. And he's a huge Atlanta Braves fan, but he had a hat on. So, you know, that NYFD with the Yankee logo, it's a hat that came out after 9/11. And it's in memory. And it was a lot of the money went to some 9/11 charities or whatever. But the fact that there was a Yankee logo on a thing, I said, "Oh, Jerry, you're a Yankee fan?" And he kind of looked at me sideways and said, "This is a New York City Fire Department hat." I said, "There's a Yankee logo on there." And he said, "You mentioned me being a Yankee fan one more time, and you and that red recorder you're holding are going to go south of here, if you know what I mean."
Uh-oh.
And he was kidding, but and I think at that moment we just sort of bonded with our wry, dry sense of humor.
Well, that's fun. I think we should go into the book side of things, but I have so many questions about the you know, past experiences and the different things that you've done over the years. I know you mentioned with Jason and Tanner and Scott that you guys got into a lot of the rock and roll side of things. But you sent me your book back in like April. I got the April draft. I don't know when we even talked about confirming the show. We talked about doing it a while ago, and I'm sorry we didn't get to do it till now, but I like the timing of this where we're, you know, a couple weeks out from before when you put the book out. But yeah. Jason and I both put a lot of time into reading and going through your new book. And I've loved it so far, Keith. I haven't got through the entire thing. I wanted to get it all the way done. I wish I would have started a long time ago and read it one story at a time. But I got a ton of the way through it. And I guess each story and each person, there's so much to what they've all done, and kind of like the, I'm not sure if I'm remembering right, if Danny mentioned it in the, Danny Glover, who we can talk about and how you two know each other. But I think he mentions in the foreword that the Black Cowboys of Rodeo and Western heritage, honestly, there's only a few that I guess really stand out from my memory. And it's on the rodeo side of things between Bill Pickett, Charlie Sampson, and Fred Whitfield. But everybody else you mentioned where you get into the, when you get into the Hargos and you talk about, you know, like James Pickens Jr. on that side of things, like his story that you wrote. I don't even know where to start on the book side of things, but I guess we should just start with the very beginning with Danny Glover and how he ended up being part and writing your foreword. Let's start right there.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you mentioned James Pickens Jr. Who plays, Dr. Weber on Grey's Anatomy. He's been on how many ever seasons that's been around now? 18?
Since 05, right?
A million.
Are they on 18 or 19?
I don't know.
How many ever seasons? He's one of only, I think, two actors that has been on every season of the show. So James and then Glenn Turman, who he's an Emmy winner. He was recently on Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. He was on the fourth season of Fargo with Chris Rock. Way back in the day, he was in the classic Cooley High. He made his acting debut on Broadway with Sidney Poitier in the original production of A Raisin in the Sun. You know, Glenn's a and of late, him and his granddaughter are featured. They're the two featured people in the Beyonce video for her new clothing line inspired by Black Cowboys. So there were two actors, and Oba Baba Tunde and Reginald T. Dorsey. So there's four guys who are Black Cowboys who happen to be actors. Yeah. And all four of those guys are in my book. Everyone was telling me about James Pickens Jr. I happened to meet Reginald T. Dorsey first, and him and I got to talking. And then, you know, Reginald set up for me to interview Oba Baba Tunde. And then I interviewed Glenn Turman. And then I interviewed James. And then I went back and interviewed Reginald. And all four of them are profiled in the book. Again, they don't simply play Black Cowboys in movies. They're Black Cowboys who happen to act. And I became friendly with all four of them. And Reginald and I, we talk all the time, our text, and we just communicate a lot. And on a Friday night in June of 2020, during the pandemic, we weren't really locked down, but there wasn't a lot open. There wasn't a lot going on. And what are you going to do on a Friday night in the middle of a pandemic? And so I was on the phone with Reginald, and I told him I really needed, I said, man, I need to figure out who's going to write my foreword. And I thought I had a list that was like pie in the sky, like really reaching. And on that list was Danny Glover. But I didn't want to say any names when Reginald and I are talking, and he said, well, hey, you know what? I agree with you. And he goes, if you want, you know, I'm not telling you who should write your foreword, but if you want, I can ask Danny what he thinks. And I said, Danny, who? Danny what? He goes, Danny Glover. And I said, dude, if you can ask Danny Glover and he happens to even say yes, he can write my foreword all day long. He can help me co-write the book if he wants to. And so we got off the phone, and Reggie sent a text telling him about the book and my project and how those four actors are in it and blah, blah, blah. And the work that I had been doing. And about 45 minutes later, Danny texted back, simply said, let's do this. And then another text came with his email address and his assistant's email address. And then on that Monday morning, I sent them an email. And a little bit later, I got an email back from Danny and his assistant. And they just said, look, we would love to write the foreword. Thanks for sending us a PDF of the book to read through. And if you can give us 2 months, we'll give you a foreword. And then it was about 2.5 months later. I just randomly on a Wednesday afternoon got the email back from them, and I saw that there was an attachment, and I was a little nervous to open it up, you know?
Oh yeah.
And then I opened it and I read it, and I have to say, I mean, it's this book that is now You know, I spent 3.5 years putting everything I had into research and writing and whatnot. And then for Danny to write what he wrote. And when people read it, there's a lot of times when a celebrity writes a foreword, all you really get is their name on the cover. And I say all like it's nothing, like that's going to sell books. Right. I got a name on the cover. And when you read it, dude put his heart into it.
Oh, yeah. 100%. It's a real,
there's real information. There's real research.
And he's
there's
been to these real events.
References to my book. Like he really read my book, and he wrote sets up the book. Like when you get done reading his foreword, you are now really ready. There's stuff that he put in that I didn't have to do in my introduction. Mm-hmm. And it was real, man. And mm-hmm. And it's Danny Glover from Lethal Weapon.
Yeah. The Danny Glover.
and he was Deets on.
Yeah. Deets from Lonesome Dove.
Yeah.
Best cowboy movie ever.
You know, and he did that for me. I'm the beneficiary. He really did it for Reginald, and also knowing Glenn, Oba, and James are part, you know, those guys being in my book is what led to him saying, I'll do it. But he ultimately did it for me. I'm the beneficiary of what he did. And I don't know how you pay that back.
And with Danny, he wouldn't, like, you technically wouldn't consider him a black cowboy that actor. He's an actor that likes our cowboy shit too.
He appreciates the history. And he understands the history, and he's a historian. And there's a movie, one of his movies is Buffalo Soldiers. And the Buffalo Soldiers sort of predate leading into Black Cowboys of the Old West. You know, they were the black soldiers during the Civil War. And so he got that movie made, you know, like, so when it comes to that history, he's working hard to make sure it's known. And then, you know, to know that I put the effort I put into it, he supported me, even though he didn't know me. And I am well aware that even with all the effort I put into this book, and what it will represent once it's out. Without those friendships, I don't get Danny Glover. But just, I mean, that's a fact. And it's not because I don't have him because I wrote a what some people might call a great book, or some people might say it's a good book, or whatever, you know. It's because of those friendships that he even picked the book up. But once he picked it up, he saw what I did, and then he wrote that foreword. And it sounds like I'm making a big deal about the foreword, but it is a big deal.
For many reasons.
There's bookstores that are gonna when you're walking through the aisle, and some of them you see the spine and some you see the front. My book in many bookstores with the name Danny Glover on it, they're gonna turn it forward.
Mm-hmm.
You're gonna see this walking through, you know, mm-hmm. and it's because of that name, you know.
And it shows to me when I read his foreword. It showed to me that it's a piece he's passionate about. And I'm not sure if you mentioned it now or if it's in one of the many stories, but he's been to the Bill Pickett rodeos and he's part of these events. Like, it's something that he might, you know, Danny Glover might not be a cowboy, but he's played them in the movies, and he might not be as authentic on the cowboy side of things as the other people in the book, the cowboys in the book, but but he it's a passion for him. In it seems like it's a passion for him in what I read and what he wrote.
He may not be a cowboy in the sense of the two ways in which we identify cowboys, working cowboy or a rodeo cowboy. So he's not gonna rodeo per se. He's been in the grand entry many, many times for the Bill Pickett. Many times he's been the grand marshal for the grand entry. He can walk up to a horse. He can go in the tack room. He can get everything he needs, saddle a horse, go riding. He knows what the hell he's doing on the back of a horse way more so than I do. Right. And when he gets done, he can unsaddle that horse, put everything away. He knows what he's doing. He absolutely, but to say, is he a cowboy or not? He's probably, not a cowboy, but he appreciates the lifestyle. And in a lot of ways that's what matters. I mean, I remember when I was with the PBR and, I was probably 6 years in at this point, That's a long time to be in something every day.
Yeah.
Every day of my life for 7 years, I woke up and went to a bull riding, wrote about bull riding, watched bull riding on TV or talked with somebody about, there was something about bull riding every day for 7 years. So I was integrated. I was in that world. And Shane Proctor asked me one day, we were just standing around on Monster Energy Cooler, I think, really, to be honest with you. And he said, hey, I got a question for you. You've been around so long. How come you, when you come here on the weekends, you haven't started wearing cowboy boots and a cowboy hat yet? And I said, man, for you, that's a lifestyle. That's who you are. For me, it would be at best, it would be a uniform. At worst, it would be a costume. In any way of that, the reverence I have for what that means to wear, and the appreciation and the understanding I have, I don't want to be in a uniform or a costume at an event because I'm going to lose the respect that you have when you talk to me. And he put his hand out. I mean, I knew this guy. I mean, I'd seen him every weekend for 6 years. And he shook my hand and he just said, that's the best way I've ever heard anyone put it. And he goes, if you ever wanted to wear a hat, you've earned the right to wear a hat. But you've also earned the right to understand why you're not. He goes, the fact that you understand why you're not, and that's the principle you believe in, I can respect that. And I think, as you know, Ted, you've been at enough different events. I'm not being cocky when I say I know I had the respect of those guys. I never did anything to disrespect any of them, and I treated them only with respect. And I think everyone understood that, even if I was wearing, tennis shoes and a pullover shirt, that I had the utmost respect for them and what they were doing.
I appreciate that too, and I respect that, Keith, on the fact the same kind of I have never had the conversation with Craig Hummer on it, but I see the Calgary Stampede on TV every year and one of the hosts and I've worked with Mark Lee and I like Mark Lee. He's not a cowboy and I think he I respect that he wants to wear a hat. I like the fact that Craig Hummer is in the same position as you were and are and takes and chooses to not wear one. I think it's more respectful for that person in that position be yourself.
As much as both Craig and I need to show our respect, man, that's the respect is a two-way street. So
yeah,
respect us for who we are, and respect us for the time we've taken to know this lifestyle, and the fact that we approach helping to tell those stories as genuine as we can.
Especially coming in as outsiders too, right? Like you guys don't have that background, never grew up around rodeo, never competed it. Like you come to it with a respectful approach, which in turn has led to gain the respect from the people within that circle.
Yeah. I mean, that's why not a week goes by that I'm not on the phone talking to somebody, you know, whether I'm not there every week anymore. Right. But I still talk with, you know, Cody Lambert and Ty Murray or Justin McBride, and you know, I'll call and shoot the shit with Jim Sharp once in a while, you know. Dang. Once a year I keep in touch with Cody Lostro, you know. There's a number of guys, you know, Luke Snyder and I'll send text messages back and forth. There's a bunch of them, you know, JB Mooney and I, you know, Jess's career really matured after I had left. I'm speaking of Jeff Lockwood, but, you know, he and I'll talk once in a while. Obviously some people know that I still write PBR stories for monsterenergy.com. Mm-hmm. And Jess is obviously a Monster Energy writer now. But I only need them for about 5 minutes to get what I need to write the short story that I write for Monster. And Jess and I might be on the phone for an hour, you know, this year. Well, I mean, we get the 5 minutes done and now it's just us talking about something, you know, something that's happening or life or what have you, you know. The same with Cooper Davis, you know. I texted him one time, this is a while back, and I just texted a compliment, a ride or something that I saw, just the way I love the way he handles himself. You can see it from afar, and I've talked to enough guys that are around him that said what you're seeing is who he is, you know. And I sent a text and I said, hey man, this is KRC, there's no reason for you to really know who I am or remember who I am, whichever case it is. But I just want to tell you that I admire and whatever it was that I had just saw happen. And he called me up and he goes, dude, I know who you are. What are you kidding? And so we kind of communicate once in a while. And I really, for me, that guy is he just feels like a leader. You know, I'm glad to see a guy like Cooper Davis in the PBR locker room today. I think those, whether the other kids understand it now or not, and they may look, I mean, they obviously look up to him because he's a world champion, but one day they're going to understand what they got from being able to put their bag next to his.
You've mentioned friendships a couple times and talking to different people on the list. We've kind of focused on this a lot so far, but I'm curious how many true friendships have come from these years of being in this business and being on the interview side. I know you've already mentioned it. You keep up with all these folks and you.
I'm gonna cut you off because. While it's on my mind, I don't want to forget how to articulate this. So obviously a little bit ago when you introduced me, you talked about, I wrote about rock and roll. I worked doing television. I toured with some bands. I was a movie critic. All the publicists I worked with, all the people that I wrote about, all the people that I would have worked with, all of that, dude, when you're not in that tunnel vision, out of sight, out of mind, by and large, not 100%, but overwhelmingly, if I see people from those points in time, we will communicate, right? But by and large, those things are fucking done. But the Cowboys, real friends.
Really?
Still friends. You can go all the way back to, and a lot of people don't know that my real introduction to the Western world, to the cowboy world, was that I pretty much went and lived with the Steiner family in 2002. And I can go, I can go 11 months, 12 months without talking to any of them. And then call Bobby Steiner on the phone, 1972 world champion bull rider, the father of Sid and Tommy Shane, the grandfather of Rocker and Steely. I can call him on the phone and tell him the book that I'm working on. We'll pimp it one more time.
Which he's mentioned in and quoted.
He's in it.
Yeah, he's in it numerous times.
More than I thought he was going to be.
Yeah, a ton.
Because I knew he knew Mertis, but then he knew Willie Thomas.
Yeah.
He knew Fred Warden. He's the one who told me that I needed to track down the Walker family in New Jersey, so which they had nothing to do with Texas and pro rodeo. But I called him and I was telling him what I was working on, and then just like that, he just started forwarding me phone numbers of people to Bubba Goodo, you know, like he's quoted in the book. And I would have never known to call Bubba. Two, Bubba would have never taken my call and called me back if it wasn't for Bobby saying,
yeah,
talk to him, you know? And so that Cowboys are cap, like, man, that there's, it's just not phony. It's for real. I mean, I'm not around the PBR every day. I'm not. And it's not like I'm going to call Sean Gleason once a week, you know, the current CEO of the PBR. But if every few months when I call him, he picks up the phone, you know. I talk to Jim Hayworth, who was the CEO between Sean and Randy for, you know, really probably two-thirds of the time that I was with the PBR, and he's a confidant, you know. He's someone in my life that I can go to for advice. He's someone that I he was more than a boss. There's a reason he was in that world, and there's something about it, you know. I mean, you know, Ty Murray, you know, I still talk to him, you know. When I go to, there's times when I go to Texas, you know, Justin will have me stay at his house, at Justin McBride, you know. And when you hear about all those people who stay with Cody Lambert, they stay in the house attached to the arena.
The bunkhouse.
The bunk, yeah, it's a really nice bunkhouse, right? Don't let that word. I mean, that's a pretty fancy bunkhouse, okay? But I stay in the actual house.
Not a big deal.
The VIP treatment.
The VIP treatment, correct? Yeah, yeah. You know, and you think about in May of 2009, my dad had what we thought was a stroke. It wasn't a stroke, but it had all the characteristics of, and they discovered he had a brain tumor, and like almost overnight, he was pretty bad shape. And that was the Friday after Memorial Day, in 2009. So that's the last week of May. And he died the Tuesday, 2 days before Thanksgiving in November of that year. And every day in between, I was either at an event with Cody, or he called, or he would text. And he knew not to ever, I think he understood my dad wasn't going to get better. Okay. So the question was never, how's your dad? They knew the end, not good. But the question every single day was, have you talked to your mom? Are you there for your mom? Every day. That's a cowboy.
I don't know Cody very well, but my experience of him has been very, it's been interesting. I remember having a time I was in Anaheim or somewhere, maybe it was Ontario, California. And I was there and there's a bunch of Canadian folks around with us. And I was trying to get a pass because I was like 20 or something. And, you know, I wasn't good enough to be there yet and thought I might've had a chance someday, but I actually earlier in the year knew where his first vest was, like his, the first bull riding protective vest. Like it actually somehow ended up in Canada. So it was up there for a while. And it was with a guy that was actually judging at the event that weekend. His name was Chad Piggins. So I worked for Chad and lived at Chad's house in the summertime. And so I was going to school in Vegas, just had left. It was fall. It was August, September. It was pretty early on, but I was trying to get a pass. And I was with Aaron Roy, and Aaron took me to the production room or whatever, and Cody was there. And Aaron was like, hey, can you get Ted a pass? And he's like, who's this guy? Why should we give him a credential? Like, what's he doing here? And he's like, oh, just with me for the weekend. You know, we're all from up there, and he's going to school in Vegas and whatnot. And Cody wasn't having it. He wasn't going to give me any kind of pass to go and hang out at the PBR. And so I piped up and I was like, well, Cody, I know where your first vest is. And he's like, what, really? Like he was kind of baffled. He's like, what, really? It's like, yeah, it's with Pig. And he told I saw it the other day. I was at the house. He's like, well, okay, well then I'll give you a pass. So I got to hang out. But and then there was another time where I told him at the world finals, and I don't know if he knows who I am or not still. We've had a couple conversations, but we got the things going with Pro Bowl Stats and with the videos attached to each out, so a guy could watch a bull. You know, he's looking at his bull, it's so and so. And I talked with Slade and got it hooked up, and I was like, well, Slade, I got these videos, so I can go and do you have a way to connect this out with that 44 and a half point bull score? And he's like, well, give me a while. And I don't know if it was a week or two or a month or a day later, or however long it was, but Slade told me, he's like, yeah, here's what you do. You give me the unique code for that out and plop it in here to Pro Bowl Stats, and then you'll link it all up. So we kind of got that going so that way. And I said, well, yeah, Cody, I saw him at the world finals. Like, yeah, Slade and I got the video thing going, and there was an influx of Canadian bulls going to the world finals, 'cause you could see him and see those outs and see what they were marked. So that's been my only interaction with Cody, but I have a lot of respect for that guy, especially with helping the guys out like Jess and a guy from back home now, Rally Gagnon's been doing very well that way. So I got a lot of respect for Cody, and hearing that story makes me appreciate what he does even more. So I'm glad he was there for you and your mom when your dad was in that kind of shape, Keith.
Yeah, he will. I'll never forget that year. I mean, him and Ty and even Randy Bernard, you know, when it happened. And I didn't know what I didn't know what to do, you know. And Randy got me a plane ticket home, and it was one way. And he said, hey, you have a PBR credit card, just use the card when you're ready to come back to Colorado. And I said, okay, just give me a week. And he said, dude, this is gonna take more than a week. And you know, we go on that summer break. And so he just said, if you want to stay there with your family and figure things out during the entire break, it's all right. You know, that's fine by me. And I don't know what made Randy say that. I don't really understand. I mean, I don't know how I got to be great friends with Ty Murray and Cody so easily, you know, other than I was just being myself. I know with Ty, like I told you, I had spent time with the Steiner family, and when Ty got wind of that, I think he had called Bobby or Sid and chatted with them, and they had, you know, good things to say about me. I think that probably went maybe a long way. Not maybe. I mean, it went a long way, you know. And but once I was friends with them, once you're at an event and you walk into a restaurant and you're basically a nobody, you're brand new, and you're sitting at the table with Ty and Cody and McBride, and then Ross Coleman sits at your table or whatever. Everyone else that I work with is off at the other tables.
Yeah.
And I know one of them had even said to me, man, you don't even know you're not supposed to sit at the table and eat with them. Like, why was that the table you walked up to? No, they brought me. I didn't walk up to the table and just sit down and say hello. I said, no, they brought me.
Oh, wow.
And people were blown away. And there were a number of folks who they would ask me like on a Tuesday or Wednesday when I was in the office, hey, are you going to be talking to Cody today? And I said, I talk to Cody every day. Can you ask him? And then they would have like two or three questions. And at first I would do it. And then after a while, I told them, I said, you know, he's not dumb. He understands what you're doing. I know what you're doing. I'm like, you're intimidated by the guy. And so you think I'll just ask and get your answer. And then that's just less interaction. I said, the more you show him how intimidated you are by him, the more difficult it's going to become. But if you just be yourself and let them see what it is you do well, what you bring to the PBR, and first and foremost, better be passion, it's all good.
What, how did you meet the Steiners and end up being around them? And then how did you?
I was living in Los Angeles. Tommy Shane signed with RCA Nashville, and a publicist from RCA called me up and said, hey, we signed a new guy. It's a country record. It's a modern, it's today's country. You know, the record came out in 2000, early 2002, I think. But it was 2001 when I got the phone call, but I don't think the record came out until after the first of the year in the springtime. But anyway, I get the call and they said he country. He's also a real cowboy. He's like a third or fourth generation cowboy. He's from Texas. His great granddad, you know, rode the range with Pancho Villa. They got this crazy history, and but his two favorite bands are Metallica and Eminem, but he's a country artist. and you being kind of a rock and roll guy who appreciates country, you would be perfect to write his bio that we're going to use when we put the record out. We'll put it on his website and send it out and blah blah blah. Would you be interested? I said, yeah, absolutely. I said, are you guys going to fly me then down to Texas so I can go there? I want to be where he's from. And Tony goes, no. It's not that we don't want you to go down. If you have to, we'll send you down there afterward. But he wants you, if it's at all possible, can you arrange to do the interview at the Rainbow Bar and Grill where Guns N' Roses filmed the November Rain video. And I was like, okay. And so on a Friday afternoon, I met Tommy Shane and his manager Adrian Michaels, and we sat in the booth from the video, we ordered pizza and drank beer and did the we had this conversation about his whole life and the record and just the everything I was going to need to write this bio. And then we were done about the time that things start to pick up on a Friday night. And then the next thing I know, I thought I was kind of done and I was going to get out of there, you know, and because I had driven and now I had drank some beers. I'm like, oh, I don't know if I should even drive home at this. And they're staying at a hotel down the street. So they were like, oh, to hell with it. You can't leave now. Now you're here for the night. And then there we were at the bar. And as you, Ted, you Wacey won't know, but Ted will know. Like, you ask any of the, I am not a drinker. And I mean, I don't know what, but I don't know how many shots of tequila we did, but we were doing tequila shots all night. And then they got me a room at the hotel that they were at, and I'm pretty sure they were at this, it was a Hyatt, but in LA it's known as the Red Hyatt. It's where all the rock bands stay when they play Los Angeles. And I don't think I went home until Sunday. And then and then the single What If She's an Angel came out. And Tommy called. We would talk on the phone from time to time. And the single was coming out. And Tommy said, man, I got to go on this radio tour. Just me and my manager. And in the Midwest, rather than fly from city to city, we're getting a bus for a big chunk of this. And I, like, you go to a radio station in the morning and you go to one in the afternoon, you go to another one in the evening, you drive all night to another city, and you do the same thing over and over and over for 5 days and kind of have the weekend off. And then you do it again. And he was going to do this for like 3 weeks. And I said, man, that sounds cool. And he goes, what's cool about being in a bus by myself with my manager? Why don't you come out with us? And I said, dude, I'm a writer. I have articles to write. And he said, you can have the back lounge. We won't do anything in the back lounge. You can keep your writer shit, whatever it is you have, your laptop, any notes, your notebook. No one will touch it. It's only going to be the three of us. Come out. And so for 3 weeks, I rode around the country going to radio stations and writing. And then when the fall came and he went to go on tour with Brad Paisley, I got this email with the tour itinerary, and I called him up and I said, hey man, cool. I like the list of shows, and man, I see there's not a Nashville one, but I will do everything I can to come to the one in Lexington. And he said, what do you mean you're coming to the one? He goes, no, I sent you the itinerary so that you know where we're going to be. Like, you're going on tour. And I said, no. Like, now you're going to have a whole bus full of people. And I said, trust me, in the country world, Tommy, you can't have a posse. And he said, well, I can have whatever I want. My it's my name, you know? And I was like, no. I tell you what, if I go out with you, I gotta have a duty. I gotta do something. Like, yeah. get something that, you know, and I had been a tour manager in the past, but I knew that, like, they had somebody else that they were gonna be using and whatnot. And so I handled merchandise for Tommy Shane for a year. And I would write. That's when I was a movie critic. So a country artist usually only plays Friday, Saturday, maybe Sunday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And then you come back home to Nashville and then you go back out. And so like in Nashville on Thursday nights, sometime between 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock in the Kroger parking lots, when you see a group of cars all parked next to one another and a tour bus pulls up, that's the band getting ready to drive out of town for the weekend. And they typically meet and keep their cars in the Kroger parking lot. That's the grocery store because it's open 24 hours. And some of them might go to like Target or something like that. But that's on the outskirts of town. There's different exits. There's not all the exits. There's select exits where that's where everybody meets up, and then you drive out of town, and then sometime on Sunday you get back home, which would allow me on Tuesdays to go spend the whole day at the movie theater watching whatever movies were going to come out that week on Friday. And so I would write movie reviews on Tuesday and Wednesday, and then Thursday through Sunday I'd be gone with Tom Shane. That was my life for about a year.
Oh, wow.
That's wild.
So when you were a tour manager, I guess I got a tour manager question, but I still want to get back to the book. We got lots more to talk about on the book side. But quickly on the tour manager side, yeah, just see some wild shit. I don't know who you did that for, but that was what you guys talked about on the NFP show with those guys. It was all rock and roll.
Right. Yeah. I mean, one time I was tour manager for my cousin's band, Tuff, T-U-F-F. And then in 2007, my cousin, who was in Tuff, was now managing a band from Sweden called Veins of Janna. And then they were signed to a label owned by Bam Margera. And then we went out on tour opening for Poison for the summer, playing amphitheaters.
Okay, I had another question about, so you mentioned Bam. What about Johnny Knoxville? What was your experience talking with him like, or what was the occasion for Knoxville?
You know, it was when I was doing movie reviews and writing about movies. And so for him, it was just, I think, I can't think of the name of the movie.
Was it the one where it was the Special Olympics thing? Or was it something?
No, the ringer? Not that one. I did the one where he played Graham Parsons from the Flying Burrito Brothers.
I don't know what that one was. Anyways, not a big deal.
Anyway, I interviewed him about a movie he made and why it was important for him to want to make the film. I think it was a direct to video movie.
Oh, okay. He seems like an interesting cat, though. I'm kind of intrigued by what he's done and respect the work he's done in that business.
Hey, man, with good reason, you know, he's not like, for him and Spike Jones and another guy, he's not an out and out jackass. He's pretty smart in that if you really watch that, it took a lot for them to conceive the whole idea of the Jackass brand. And so for him to do what he did, I mean, that's like if someone were to stumble across your podcast and they think just because you call it cowboy shit that you don't take it serious. But there's a whole... There's a whole story to the brand. There's a lot of work that goes into doing what you do, you know, and imagine the level at which Jackass got to, the work that went into it.
Oh yeah. It's impressive.
He wasn't one of those secondary jackasses, you know. He was one of the brainchilds behind it.
Okay, back to the book. Why did you write this book? Why was it Black Cowboys of Rodeo? You know, I just got to ask why this project?
Yeah. A lot of the why comes with how. So Ty Murray in I think it was around 2009, Ty introduced me to Mertis Deitman, and I got to know Mertis. And the first time that I had a conversation with him, when I got done with that conversation, I turned to Ty afterward, and I said, "Hey, man, I don't know when, but one day I'm going to write a book about Mertis Deitman." And he said, "Oh yeah, really?" I said, that may be one of the most fascinating people I've ever had a conversation with. And he said, "Oh, okay." And he just, I don't want to say he blew it off, but you know, I think he thought it was me in the moment and then I was going to forget about it. And, but life happens, and I'm working with the PBR, I'm doing all the whatever. And so, in 2007 or 17, when I started to think about it's time to write a book, what am I going to write? I had a few different ideas, and Mertis was one of them. And I had a conversation on the phone with Mertis and Mertis Jr., his son. And the more I talked to Mertis Sr., the more he would just mention Bailey's Prairie Kid and Freddie Gordon and Harold Cash and Willie Thomas and all these other people. And I got to thinking, if I write a book about one guy, I'm contributing to the misinformation that there really aren't that many Black Cowboys, and that Mertis, if someone read it, they're going to read it and think, oh, another anomaly, another one of those rare Black Cowboys. And so I ended up coming up with the idea that I did for the book I wrote, kind of based on the story span 100 years. They go all over the country, you know, hence from Harlem to Hollywood and the American West. So I covered the country, and it shows people, it's not the definitive book, because I don't believe any book or any movie can be definitive unless you're Ken Burns doing a 24-hour documentary, you know, 12 parts, 2 hours a night. But a 400-page book covering 100 years, it's not definitive, but it's pretty comprehensive. And so I give you a very comprehensive look at the evolution of Black Cowboys. And they're not exactly in chronological order, but they're pretty close. And if you can read any, you can read any one of those profiles in and of itself. But if you do read them in chronological order, you're going to see a little bit of the evolution over that 100-year time. And so I thought that was doing a better service on my part to bringing out these untold stories. As a matter of fact, I think this doesn't need to turn into a book reading, but you know, I'll just read the dedication, because I think the dedication really sets up what I felt I was doing. Former Washington Post president and publisher Philip L. Graham once lamented that news serves as, quote, the first rough draft of history, end quote. Unfortunately, when it comes to more than 150 years of Black Cowboys, a vast majority of those drafts were wrong, and the few that had it right were either ignored, lost, or at best forgotten. The profiles chronicled in Black Cowboys of Rodeo and the thousands of other Black Cowboys those stories represent are my small part in a much larger ongoing effort to write a second draft and in the process correct history. This is for those who never had their story told.
That's
a good way to set the tone for the book. Okay? That's like kind of the essence of the whole thing.
Yeah.
Did you have any kickback, like on the, like being a white guy writing a book about the Black Cowboys of Rodeo? I wonder that way. Was there any pushback that way? No, is there all respect? They respect
no,
what you want to do.
No, not never, never, no.
No, nothing to do with it.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, a lot of them were thankful. So you can't say their stories have never, ever been told, but for most of them, they never got to tell their whole story. Over the years, whenever they would get written about in a newspaper or what have you, it would be like a little snippet. And a lot of times the snippet never got past, hey, this perk that where they would describe a cowboy, and it would be some hokey urban description of a cowboy. And then it was almost like a punchline. By the way, he's black. That's what got written about, you know? And so for once, these guys were sitting down, man, and they were having real conversations with someone they could tell cared. Someone who gave a shit about who they were, what they did, and how they got to be who they are. That I cared about it. And whether it was a black cowboy, an African American studies scholar, whether it was, you know, someone at the Schomburg Center for African American Research in Harlem, the Smithsonian, whoever I talked to, not one time did I get, you know, I interviewed a former executive director of the Civil Rights Museum at the Lorraine Motel in Memphis, where Martin Luther King was assassinated. I never got kickback. Hey man, you're white. No. There were a few people who didn't talk, but it didn't have to do with I was white.
I think it all ties back to your how authentic you are with your approach, right? You don't pretend to be somebody you're not. And you, like you said, you give a shit about these stories. And I think that's, if you show genuine interest with anybody, they're going to want to share their story with you.
Yeah. I mean, that goes with whether you're writing a book or not, even just having a conversation with someone, man. You know, when you, there's times where you might be in a bar and you think you're just gonna shoot the shit with somebody because they happen to be at the table, and all of a sudden you have a real conversation, and the next thing you know you're like, oh man, I didn't think I was gonna be here, you know, I didn't plan on having three beers and talk for 4 hours.
I don't know how far to get into the racism side of things in rodeo, and in my experience I have not seen it personally. And
you're in Canada.
Yeah. And where everybody's nice up here, right? We murder statement won the guy we recorded in Calgary in 1970.
Like, if that's not a joke, and that's not only now, because I'm gonna tell you about a black cowboy. He's not in my book because he's not a rodeo cowboy. But do you know John Ware?
Know the name. Okay. Wacey, we met for breakfast there with your dad one time. You guys lived really close by. It's a down south of Calgary here.
Bar U Ranch.
Bar U, yeah. Sorry, Bar U Ranch.
What was it? Isn't the Revenant loosely so right based off of John Ware?
The John Ware Ridge. I mean, it's a huge... Yeah. The landscape is named after him. Anyway, John Ware was a slave from South Carolina. And when they were freed after the Civil War, he was one of the many who went west to Texas. And he had already knew how to ride a horse. He had a few little skills and he learned how to cowboy. And then what happens is many of those guys would end up on the Chisholm Trail pushing cattle from Texas up to Kansas. And then they put that cattle on a train and they send them back east. Well, John Ware became famous and more so in Canada than anywhere. But again, began as a slave in South Carolina. Instead of loading that cattle onto the train in Kansas, he pushed 300 head of cattle. Now this is in the 1800s. I don't have that date in front of me or memorized, but obviously after the Civil War and before the Old West was done. So we're talking somewhere between 1865 and 1895. I want to say it was around 1880, 1885. He pushes 3,000 head of cattle past Kansas all the way into southern Alberta, where the John Ware Ridge is. The reason they call that the John Ware Ridge is he pushed that cattle up there. And that, my friends, is the birth of the cattle industry in Canada. So the first cattle in your country were pushed there, brought there by a former slave from South Carolina. And so he ends up meeting a woman up there, and he stayed in Canada, and he lived along the what is now the John Ware Ridge. And I think had a couple kids with his wife, and basically that's where he called home until he was unfortunately tragically killed while galloping his horse at a high speed across a meadow. His horse stepped in a badger hole, and it flipped over and landed on top of him and crushed him to death. And that's how he unfortunately passed. In Canada, you guys have honored him, and you put John, a Black Canadian, now a Black Canadian cowboy, on a Canadian postage stamp before we ever put Pickett on a postage stamp.
And you got the picture right too.
Eventually they got it right, but not initially. They spent over $1 million to correct it.
Yeah, that was a wild story too. I don't want to give away too much in the book either. And part of why, like, I wish I would have finished the whole thing, but I didn't want to. I want to wait till I can get the paper copy in my hands, Keith, and read the whole thing. I got in, and I'm a certain amount through. I've got I read all the way about halfway. And I wanted to save it because I was enjoying it so much. And I'm sorry I didn't read the whole thing. But
no,
I'm also not sorry because I'm being selfish because I want to pick up the paper book and buy a copy and I want to read it I don't read online. I don't have a Kindle or nothing. Everything I read is a paper. So I selfishly want to read the rest of it in my hands when I can get the actual paper copy and we can have another conversation afterwards.
You know how many people you do interviews with and they don't...
they read none of it?
They haven't even had it, you know? All they have in front of them is a piece of paper that says the name of the book.
Yeah. I want to honor you by buying a copy and having a... I might buy five or six and give a bunch out here up our way. Well, and maybe we can do a promotion or something. Or I don't know. But I want to help you because I think... After reading what I, you know, getting halfway through, I think these stories are so they're instrumental in the formation of the American cowboy and the cowboy overall in modern times. But they're, like you mentioned, they're untold, not necessarily untold stories, but this is the first time this collection has been put together and chronologically.
No collection like it.
Yeah, there's nothing like it. And so further to that, though, I have to ask what your goals with this book are and what they were and where you see it going. I remember talking to Kendra Santos, and she told me that like her book wasn't a big moneymaker, the one that Rustock with Ty. She said it wasn't a big moneymaker. And I don't know if that's because of the market was so small with Ty at the time, even though he was the biggest cowboy in the world. I think that with what you're doing and what you've done with this book that's coming out, for those that don't know, I don't think we've mentioned it yet, but November 1st. Yeah, November 1st, Black Cowboys of Rodeo, Unsung Heroes from Harlem to Hollywood in the American West by our friend on the show here right now, Keith Ryan Cartwright. You're going to be able to get it, I'm assuming, anywhere books are sold.
Yep. Everywhere books are sold, you can buy it.
Everywhere. So tell me about some of the goals, though, because there's a lot to you. You're 4 years into this project. essentially before it's published? You start in 2017 and there's
I started in earnest July of 2017 and I turned it in to my publisher at the end of October 2020. And then once they have it, once you turn it in, then it's 1 year before it comes out. So I basically needed about a year and a half, or 3.5 years, and then they needed a year. And so it's 4.5 years in the making. And it's time consuming because I started from scratch and I basically just followed the stories. You know, Murtis told me about Bailey's Prairie Kid. Then I talked to Bailey's Prairie Kid. And then Bailey told me about Harold Cash. And I talked to Harold Cash. And then Harold told me about Freddie Gordon. And then I talked to Freddie Gordon. And then Freddie Gordon told me about the rodeo in Harlem in 1971. And that led me to finding Cleo Hearn and then Bud Bramwell. And then Nelson Jackson and Marcus Friday and Irvin Williams. And, you know, so I just found my way around the country, you know, and it took time. And I wanted to make sure that if somebody told me about someone that I had that conversation. I kept having conversations. And then if there anything good came of the pandemic, I couldn't travel, right? None of us could, you know? And so that is basically when I was like, all right, I have almost 3 years worth of research and interviews, and you may or may not know, I had about 500 conversations with 150 or so different people for a total of 800 hours that I transcribed. And I paid a couple people to help me transcribe because that's a lot of hours of transcription. And so the 400 pages you see here is largely from those 800 hours of conversation, as well as the research of everything that I could find that had been written, you know, because sometimes I wanted to compare and contrast what had been written and what was being remembered, you know, and sometimes what was being remembered might be a romantic version of what was written. And then other times what was written romanticized the Black Cowboy. And today the Black Cowboy is like, no. Like for instance, in the LA Times once had an article where there's a famous stable on the corner of El Segundo and Figueroa. It's in LA. And in the article, it says 2,000 horses. They said, go to this corner and you would never know there were 2,000 horses. Well, that's because there were probably never 200 horses at one time. There were 200 horses, but not at one time. There definitely was never, ever 2,000 horses at a stable at that intersection. You know, and it was the naivety and the ignorance of that writer, whether it was a typo and they hit the zero one too many times or two too many times, I don't know, or if they were trying to win an award for some big dramatic article, I have no idea, but I corrected their history. And so they were the ones that romanticized it in the moment. And I had guys today backing me up like, no, there weren't 2,000. That's a lot of horses.
Oh,
that's
yeah, especially in LA, like literally a movie ranch in LA. That would a little bit off there, folks. So going back to another question, it's come back to me a couple times here, and I wrote down a bunch of notes as we've been going. But I'm curious why you left the PBR when you did? What was the motivation to move on to the next part of your career? And based on things that was based on your career, your time with PBR was one of the things you spent the most time on in your professional career so far.
Yeah, I did for about 6 months contemplate to myself that if I was going to continue past when I did, that I was going to be digging my feet in, and I was going to stay there forever. Like that would be my forever job.
Yeah.
Or as a storyteller, were there other stories to tell? And in the end, I sort of felt like there were some other stories to be told. And, you know, I think some people know that prior to leaving, I started work on a graduate degree. So once I left the PBR, I got a master's degree from Harvard, and then, and I relocated back to Nashville where I had lived previous to joining the PBR. And I thought I was going to work on a project with Brad Paisley, but I ended up making a documentary with Kenny Chesney and Sean Silva. And that's sort of what I did. And coming out of the PBR, and then I knew that I was going to work on a book, you know, and really making a concerted effort to write a book. One of the people really urging me was not necessarily this book, but a book was conversations I would have with Justin McBride, and me kind of saying to him as a storyteller, I wonder, what am I doing now? Where am I going? Where's this journey going to take me? And he just said, Diablo, I've told you all the time, man, I'm waiting for a book. You gotta write a book, time to write a book. And whenever I would say something, he goes, man, I don't understand what you're trying to figure out. It's time to write a book. And so then I started work on the book.
Okay, you mentioned Diablo. What's the story on that nickname?
So, I'll give you the straight up story on Diablo. You remember when Silvano Eldez came to the United States when he first came? And I might get this wrong, but I think he rode his first 10 bulls. I mean, he looked like the machine that Lemmy really is, right? And so I wrote an article after he was like 10 for 10 and won two events. And because I think his first event was a World Cup or something like that. And then he stayed and won the first two events, or won an event and won the third. I mean, he did really well out of the gate. I write an article and I'm saying all the great things that he had done. And I can see you're looking it up. So you're gonna give us the actual what he did. And in the article, I say all these great accolades, but there's one line in there where I wrote, however, we haven't seen him on a 45-point bull yet. That's the one thing he's gotta show us. Now, I wasn't saying he couldn't. I wasn't saying he wouldn't. All I did was say all these great things he had come and done, and we were all blown away. Everyone was blown away when Silvano first came. I mean, he was lights out. And all I said is, that's all we have to see, man. And I meant it like, that's all we got to see. And this guy is a world champ. And obviously, he did ride those bulls, and he did win three world titles. However, when Adriano read the article and he read that one line, he took it that I was trying to poke a hole in Silvano. He took it that I was demeaning Silvano, that I was talking bad about him. And he said, that's bullshit. It's bullshit that this guy did this. I was a huge proponent of all the Brazilian riders. I got along. I mean, by that point, I was living in Fort Worth by then. I was hanging out at Galermi's house. I would go to Robson's. I would spend time at Valderon's house. And, you know, I meant no disrespect, none whatsoever by saying that. I was just pointing out the one thing we're left to see. Like, we haven't seen it all. We're still going to see this. And Adriano was really upset. And Randy Bernard had left. And he wasn't there. And I don't really know what was going on, but Sean Gleason was sort of a intermediate leader of the PBR. And Adriano called him on the phone, and he basically told him about the article and said, I think it's bullshit that he couldn't just compliment the kid. He had to throw in a backhanded compliment. You know, he had to write that shitty comment, you should fire him. And Sean laughed and he said, I'm not going to fire that guy. You can't fire him. He goes, I read the article. It's a positive article. What are you kidding? Yeah. And then that's when Adriano said, no. He's bad for our sport. His words are the words of the devil.
Diablo.
and so, when Mac heard that, I've been Diablo ever since.
Okay, for the record, Silvano rode his first 15 bulls in PBR competition, according to
the article. But I think the article came out when he was 10 for 10.
Yeah, there you go. So, to your point, he came and looks like, I guess I can confirm here, actually. So, this was all touring pro from November 2009. To January of 10. Dude,
don't look at the touring pro. Look at the Built Ford Tough.
So I've got 8 in a row on the Built Ford Tough, but I have a declined rewrite at 69 points at the World Cup. So he's got 8, and then it looks like he got bucked off his 9th bull in Des Moines. But my point being, it was Nampa. Looks like, so let me just confirm here, Nampa. It looks like he probably, he won Nampa, which was his first BFT. And then it looks like he probably won Billings too. No, he didn't. Doesn't look like he won Billings. But anyways, won his first event in Nampa. Looks like he did well at the World Cup. But to your point, for the 45-point bulls, I didn't find him riding a 45-point bull until the next year in Anaheim in 2011, where he stayed on a 45-point bull. So to your point, take that, Adriano. And it took a while, really.
Yeah.
And he was the world champ next year, was he not? In 11?
Yeah. I didn't get fired. Silvano won 3 world titles. He's also one of them that I can send a text message to from time to time. I've never had any ill. It was a weird deal. Like, and I really think that Adriano he misunderstood.
Missed the point, yeah.
The line.
It's probably lost in translation.
Totally, because I said, you know, like I said, it's the only thing we haven't seen is him ride a 45-point bull.
Yeah, and then he does it and wins the world. That
we're now that's what we're waiting. When we see that, we will have seen he can do everything.
Yeah,
that's what I meant by like you said, I think it was a little bit lost in translation, and then. It got under, and there was a lot of, if you remember back then when Justin and J-Dub coaching the World Cup teams and Adriana, there was a lot of rambunctiousness surrounding the what was the World Cup and had now become the Global Cup, you know. Behind the scenes, there was a lot of fire. Those guys wanted to win, you know. Yeah. And what was funny is, I think the coaches wanted to win more than the riders wanted to win. Either that or the riders wanted to win, And those coaches from that era that they came from was the era of they did not want to lose. And they didn't want to lose to one another. And I'm in the middle of, I wasn't stoking a fire, but someone had something they wanted to say. I was listening. Cause I don't think Justin coach, I think J Dub might have been a World Cup coach at that year.
Justin was still,
I think trying to get Justin riding, to come back
for some of them.
Yeah.
Your favorite story you ever wrote for the PBR, real quick. For me, it was your work with Frank Newsom.
Yeah, I mean, the three, there's several that kind of stand out with the PBR. The Robson Palermo story that I wrote after he won the 2008 World Finals event. The Adriano retirement story. The story that I wrote about Brendan Clark after he nearly died in Omaha, and Tandy basically saved his life in the arena. Tandy Freeman's story about being the everything doctor for everyone that's involved that wears a cowboy hat. And Frank Newsom. Those are probably, I didn't like science class when I was in school, but I wrote a magazine piece for Pro Bowl Rider when that magazine still existed. Gosh, it must have been a 5 or 6 page spread on the clones. And I mean, I went and watched them make the clone in the Petri dish and did the research on the science behind cloning. I incorporated the religious morals. Is it right or wrong? Is it right or wrong in competition? Like, I was really in depth. It was, so I guess somehow I got to take one of those other articles out and Adriano, you called me Diablo. So I'm taking your article out. I'm going to put the clones in my spot.
Okay. How about now though, my comment on the journalism side of things. And I have not paid close enough attention lately, but I think that some of those longer form really, do you call it a humanity piece? Like I'm not a journalist to know enough about
human interest.
Human interest. That some of that stuff has gone away more lately. I haven't seen as many of those long form pieces that I've really seen shared around social to a point where it's something that I want to read about a guy in the PBR side of things. I haven't seen a lot of it lately.
People don't have the attention span for it nowadays.
Is that what it is? Or is it the lack of the content coming out? I'm not throwing a slight at PBR or Felisco, but are they just not doing it as much? Has it not been a focus lately? Or have I just not seen it? Have I just not been paying attention to see it?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I'll say this. If people didn't have a focus or an attention span, they wouldn't read a book, but they're reading books.
Yeah.
Like people are still I will admit there aren't as many outlets. There aren't as many places for those longer pieces. But I think even when I was there, there would be people who would argue like, people don't want to read, you know, but the Frank Newsom deal, that's probably, I have a hard time thinking that, for all the wrong reasons, the Mason Lowe obituary may have passed it in the amount of hits and reads that the Frank Newsom story, but straight up mid-season article, and as long as that one was, I proved people if you write something and you start, the little buzz gets created when people read it and they can feel the heartbeat, they can feel the passion, they can feel the sincerity. It it took off like wildfire. And for a long, long time, that was the nothing, whether it, you go back to PBRnow.com to PBR.com, that new, that Frank Newsom story was the most read deal. But I will say, I, for all the wrong reasons, unfortunately, I think the Mason Lowe obituary probably got a lot of attention.
I need to get to your take on the World Finals moving to Fort Worth and the season switch up. What are your thoughts on that quick? And then Wacey, you can finish it up and then we'll call it good here. I got to get going, but we appreciate your time, but two quick ones before we're done.
And I said it from the get-go. You give Texas an opportunity to host the PBR and the PRCA, man, they are not going to let go. And what Texas wants, Texas kids. And and Texas has one thing that Las Vegas doesn't. They have a state government. They have the city of Fort Worth. They're all working in concert with one another. They wanted this, and they got what they wanted, man. And I told you it was unfortunate for that it was COVID that gave Texas this opportunity to host the PBR and then the NFR. And so now you see the PBR's taking its world finals to Fort Worth. I also think Fort Worth is a real city to keep an eye on. I think it's on an uptick. You look at, they built that Dickies Arena. It's downtown in the cultural district. They're revitalizing the stockyards. You go to downtown Fort Worth and you just start to look at hotel and convention stuff that's going on. And then I've seen a number of articles where it, maybe not in Fort Worth, it might be over in Arlington, but I think you're going to start to see, I think you can start to see some casinos, you know, and then it'd be game over.
What about why in May though? Like, I'm not going to go to Fort Worth in May for really, even if it is the World Finals.
You say that, but if they give you an opportunity, like.
Yeah, if they give me an opportunity, but I'm just not going to pay my own money to go as a fan to watch personally, because in May in Canada is a nice time of the year, and I think I'll probably stay home and watch it personally.
Well, you don't have a huge population up there in Canada, okay?
Yeah, for sure. So we're a small market.
There's a
we're
handful
minor
of
details.
People that live in an area where you're going to say, hey, this is the best time of the year to be at home. But yeah, for most of us, that isn't really the case. I think putting it in the centralized in the United States, I think giving itself that a little distance from the NFR, you can't put the PBR World Finals in Vegas in May. It's proven people aren't, you want to talk about where they're not going to Vegas in May.
Yeah, for sure. And I'm probably not going to Texas in May, but that might be different for a lot of folks. But then again, and I'm just speculating, and I haven't heard for sure, but I think that there's a split season now where the World Finals are Fort Worth in May, and then the maybe there's a team scenario coming out that I haven't, maybe it's out, maybe it's not, I don't know, but I think there's a team finals maybe in the fall still in Vegas. Like, that's what I'm just assuming at this point. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I heard the wrong info, or I'm not sure, but like, what are your thoughts on that kind of scenario? If it was Fort Worth in November, I'd be all over it. I would be there for sure. But I'm not so sure about the split season with the team format, and I'm not sure if the team format's really going to fly.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll have to wait. I haven't said for sure. I mean, we hear a lot of people talking about it, but see how that goes.
What's your take, though?
It's interesting that you would go to Fort Worth in November, but you don't want to go in May.
because it's nice at home in May. I'm gonna golf in May at home.
Okay, so yeah. It doesn't matter what's happening in May. You're not going to the event.
No, I'm gonna be at home. We have too many events at home in May as well, right? For as far as there's a lot of big rodeos on that time of year. It's just getting nice here finally after 7 months of winter, and you know, in November. It's fall and it's busy and it gets cold in Canada. So yeah, we'll go down. But in May, it's nice. I'm not going.
But to play devil's advocate, then in November, you're willing to go to the PBR World Finals. But there's a lot of people who say they're always having to make a choice between PBR World Finals or the NFR.
That's fair.
Whereas if you break them up, that might be their choice of their vacation in the summertime, you know?
Yeah, they might go to both.
Yeah, now they can do both.
And for that, too, putting it on the Memorial Day weekend for you guys in the U.S., is that the case or am I off on the dates? Is it not Memorial Day? Like, is it not?
I think it's the weekend. I think, well, it's two
weekends.
They do a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, then a Thursday, yeah. Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Yeah.
I think it ends the weekend before Memorial.
Okay. I was going to say I wasn't sure if the weekend was a draw or not or whatnot. But anyways, I was curious to get your take on it a little bit. And then we could talk about the team safe stuff, but I think we have to do another show sometime here, Keith, to talk more.
And we've only been talking about rumors anyway. I mean, until we know for sure something's happening.
Yeah. 100%. I just don't see them finishing the year in May and, you know, only going that 6 weeks, and they've already mentioned they're going to do something else. So anyways, Wacey, you wrap it up. And we'll call her good.
I have two things before we wrap up.
Yeah,
I noticed that Nickelback is on your list. I want to know if you think that the internet hate that they get is just or just because people think it's cool to make fun of Nickelback on the internet.
Well, you know, here's what's weird.
I love Nickelback as a premise.
I don't have a problem with Nickelback either, because this is my problem. Like, the people who bag on, like, there's people who bag on them and they're really loud about it, right?
That's the worst.
They're really, really loud about bagging on Nickelback. But how many records in a row sold over 10 million copies?
Man, they're like they're one of the greatest Canadian rock bands ever. And their music is awesome. Greatest rock bands
ever.
Yeah, literally. Yeah. Any rock, especially of our generation, too, right?
Like, I'll just say, everyone 50 and over or 45 and older, they want to punch you in the face right now for saying that instead of Rush. But I'm with you. I would listen to Nickelback. I would listen to the same song over and over and over all day for 24 hours. You could force me to stay awake and listen to one song over and over and over before I'm made to listen to the Rush catalog. So
I agree with that.
I'm with you, but I've never understood that some of the hatred and things that people say about Nickelback. That said, I do understand it when it comes to Creed. I love Creed. I thought that was a yeah, that was junk. It was junk. And at one time, this is a funny story. So I did not write a preview in the Tennessean for a Creed concert, but I was at the Creed concert to write a concert review. So mind you, I have not yet written the review of Creed. They're on stage playing. And Scott Stapp, he's off stage. When he comes back out, he's holding the Tennessean, the newspaper, and he reads what is really a snarky preview. And then urges the audience. Now, meanwhile, the seat I'm sitting in is press row, and I'm the only press there. So I'm in a row where there's like four empty seats on either side of me, and I'm holding a notebook and I've been taking notes. And so he's bagging on the Tennessean up on stage. Everyone around me turns and they're facing me. And I thought, oh my God. And he's really bagging on the paper. And security from the South Amphitheater, because the promoters, all those girls that worked for the South in the front office, they knew where I was and they knew I was by myself. And they thought that somebody is going to punch him in the face thinking I wrote what was in the paper. So they get me out of the audience and into the office. And then I write my review, which is also not kind, not too shitty, but it's not kind. And the Tennessean has no idea at the actual Tennessean office that Scott had done anything on, said anything about the paper on stage.
That's a lot.
The next day, a random call comes into the paper and they said, oh, hey, we wanted to, you know, we read this article by Keith Ryan Cartwright. And how can we send him, you know, I just want to congratulate him on such, you know, such a good review that he wrote. And one thing led to another, and they gave them my email address, but it's not a Tennessean address. It's my email address. And I'm at home working, and all of a sudden my computer goes ding. Ding 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 ding.
Oh no!
They posted my email address on all these Creed message boards.
Oh no!
And all the little Creed kids, whatever you, what do they call? What were you guys called?
I don't know.
Probably creeps.
Yeah, not that hardcore of a fan.
Okay, so you weren't one of them who emailed me.
No, hell no.
I got so many came in such a short time that they locked my email account. And then I had all kinds of emails saved that I really needed. And I had to call, and I'm going round and round saying, here's what happened and da, 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 da. And they said, well, can't you just start a new email address? I said, no, I mean, it's my work email. Like, I use this for work. Like, all these publicists have it and blah, blah, blah. And so they said, I said, can you just turn it back on and just delete anything that came in the last 24 hours. And they said, no, really, we usually just discard these email when something like that happens. Like, it's an overload to the
system, man. You know.
And they said, the only thing we can do that will allow you to keep your email address is we have to wipe the whole thing clean. So I lost all the emails, all the messages that I really needed to return for whatever. Like, I lost everything, but it took about 72 hours. I got my email address back.
Holy.
But
that's, yeah, wild. The beef with Creed.
They were crazy.
Last question, wrap it up, Keith. What is your definition of cowboy shit?
Shit that has to do with a cowboy.
I mean, like, you kind of touched on a lot of it as we talked to, like, the essence of it and talking about the book and the just the authentic relationships you've had with those people. So yeah, and we can probably, like, pull together a bit of a definition out of that stuff.
You're talking about we talked about cowboy shit. It's all the things that have to do with being a cowboy, and that's the spirit of the cowboy, the technical stuff of a cowboy, like all things having to do, all the, you know, I use the word thing, all things or all shit having to do with being a cowboy. That's what cowboy shit is.
We like it.
Thanks, Keith. Really like Black Cowboys of Rodeo, Unsung Heroes from Harlem to Hollywood and the American West. Keith's book is out November 1st, anywhere books are sold. Support Keith, support the Western heritage. Black Cowboys of Rodeo. It's Wacey and I have both gone into it a long way so far. Check out Keith's work as well. Follow him on Twitter. Check out his website. Again, Black Cowboys of Rodeo, out November 1st. Thanks to the author, Keith Ryan Cartwright. We appreciate your time. Thank you.
This ain't some rhinestone bit. This ain't some circus show. Your son, this is pure cowboy shit. Ancient daddy's rodeo. No, it ain't his rodeo.
Thanks to our guest this week, Keith Ryan Cartwright. Appreciate you being on the show. His new book, Black Cowboys of Rodeo, From Harlem to Hollywood in the American West, coming out November 1st, wherever books are sold. Wacey, Cowboy Shit is brought to you proudly by Manscaped and Circle 4 Beverage Company. Tell us about those fine sponsors.
Oh, we got, so as I mentioned in the first half, Circle 4 Beverage Company, they've been with us for a while now. They got the sweet water. They got the ranch water. Basically, in most prairie liquor stores, you can find their stuff now. But yeah, check them out, circle4beveragecompany.ca. You can find their store locator. Check them out on social media at Circle 4 Ranch Water and stay up to date with what they're doing. And we got...
Oh, wait. Before we go too much further, we have a personal endorsement from Kobe Moore on Ranch Water. And,
oh, right. Yeah.
And Sweetwater.
Well, there's even more.
It's a testimonial.
There's even more. Last night, I was out to dinner with some of the guys and their girlfriends at Earl's, and there was a gal from Medicine Hat who was asking, how is that ranch water? And I was just like, lady,
it's damn good.
It is made around the corner from you. What are you doing? Why haven't you not tried this? But no, I brought a 4-pack over to my dad this summer and just on a whim, see what he would think. He enjoys his tequila and he got one sip into the thing and asked me where he can invest. So I mean,
damn, there you go.
My dad knows his booze and quite enjoys the ranch water and the sweet water. Brought a little bit of that over to him the other day and those went down just as smooth, he said. So I just don't think there's anything on the market when it comes to your just seltzers, coolery drinks, if you will, that you can pour over ice and that go down like a damn water. And then you feel really different after a couple of those. 100th episode party was sponsored by Ranch Water in my world. I'll tell you that.
That right was now. Ridiculous. That was a hell of a time.
Yeah, it was a good time.
How many people do that, Wacey? Like, how many people have backyard karaoke parties? Is that a thing?
Not
like,
many people. Not many people. No. I'm glad that we do it because I think it's great. It's so fun.
Yeah, that was way cool. I had way too much fun that night.
Wait, turns out Covey is a big Sublime guy.
Great, man. There was a couple of performances that got hammered out, which is great. It was good to see you back under. Behind the mic. Yeah, Preston, he does good at Man Down Under, actually.
Yeah, that was wild.
And then Ted, he said, good to see Teddy back on the mic for his iconic New York. If you ever get a chance to hear that, people, like, you want it. It's excellent. That's right in
what
Teddy's
you think of King of the Road, though, too. I think that might
that's
be
good one, too. I just New York, just a bit more, like, you got a little bit more...
More jam to it,
a little bit, yeah, a little more, yeah, a little bit more showbiz, baby. okay. Also, we can't forget about our friends from Manscaped again. Bush. Get 20% off free worldwide shipping using code HUGEBUSH at manscaped.com. It's huge cuffing bush. Season. You don't want hairy pumpkins heading into cuffing season. You want, if you're fooling around the corn maze, you want to make sure the pumpkins are clean. So, you get 20% off with code HUGEBUSH at Manscaped from us to you. We got the right tools for the job at Manscaped. Get it done right, baby.
Are you hiring a scripting for marketing company? Because that was gold.
I was just made that up as I went along.
I love it. The pumpkins. Keep the pumpkins tidy, boys.
Okay. Keep them pumpkins Kobe, clean. I think our next segment of the show is your buckle. I think we need to discuss
Kobe's
this.
Buckle.
Yeah.
I've got a buckle. I guess I've been around the sport a little while and noticed that a lot of people have some pretty cool buckles, and I've never really been someone that wants to go out of my way to make sure I get one or do anything as badass as anyone else does. But I've been seeing a lovely young lady for a little while now, and she happens.
She's real. I've seen her.
She's real. I've seen her. She had a little accomplishment back in her day, and so I've been running around wearing. Hold on here. Let me get this thing
you
off.
Want me to hold that?
Yeah. Let's get this now this is awkward. Get your mouth out of my face. But Miss Pinoca Stampede 2020 or 2017.
Is that Troy Fisher?
I'm not sure. It's got Jones Boys on it.
It's the Jones Boys spectacular.
But I don't know, it's at her place. I think it's a badass buckle, and you always hear guys wearing either their traveling buddies one something that's not one they're going to stick on their belt right away, or giving it to your girlfriend. I said, well, let's just flip this script and see what the hell happens and wear a misplay.
I like that move a lot. I respect that. That's awesome.
Hell yeah. You got to have a little bit of balls in this community to do that. But I think most people just recognize that it's a pretty sick looking buckle, and there's not much to be said there. I like the look of it.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Still warm.
That's nasty. That's such a oh no.
I had a funny story I'll tell you guys when we're done recording about something that happened to my
That's not good.
I can't. No, honestly, no. I have family listens to this podcast, and it is not a family-friendly story.
It can't be worse than the first couple episodes dropping 37.
No, like this F-bombs. Is not like I'm not comfortable telling this when I know that people who I know are listening.
Fair enough.
But it makes me think of it. Happened in Lethbridge, Ted, when we were together that one year.
I like it though, Kobe.
That's awesome, man. I like that move.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Give it a go. Maybe I'll learn.
I haven't worn a buckle in so long, so if I ever end up dating another horse girl, I might start wearing her buckles.
Do it.
I think you should.
And then make TikToks about it and just go after it.
Man, I got TikTok in the palm of my hand.
When are you gonna bring Kobe and me into TikTok?
Please don't bring me to TikTok.
Need backup?
I have some ideas for TikToks with more than like just like some for us that we need to do. Okay. So we'll have to do a content day, one of these ones.
I can't help but notice there's a lot of new cowboy shit merch rolling around the world currently. When are we renting like a Ferrari or something? Because this is like Vice. This is Vice City, and that would make a great Miami set of photos.
Do we gotta get white sunglasses and Ferraris?
We gotta go like MacGruber looks.
Well, when he shows up to the party, we can probably do this photo shoot in about 18 to 24 months when Ted gets a good mustache going.
That's gonna be another 18 to 24 years.
We can just get him a fake. Let's get him a fake stash. Thanks for mentioning that, Kobe. We got some new merch that just dropped. That's pretty cool.
We've got a new black hoodie.
Got new hoodies.
80s vibe designed by the one and only Storm Defoe. We also got to get this on a hat. We don't have it done yet. But
I think it's going to be a deadly hat for sure. I think that people are going to eat that logo up.
I don't have the blue one handy. Do you, Wacey?
No, I don't.
I don't either. But it's on the website, cowboyshit.ca.
Yeah, check it out.
Check out the new merch. In stores now and at cowboyshit.ca. New stores every day, and I got some new hats on the go as well. So
and we got some big stuff coming from Montana Silversmiths too, which is really neat. Stay tuned for something.
Seen it in some of the photos. We kind of just teased it out a little.
We're teasing it. We're just giving you a little taste, little teaser. Also, well, Ted, we also did a thing, and you got some season tickets to the Flames.
Oh yeah,
that's a big move. Making money moves.
The game the other day. I went.
Hockey is back. How nice was it to be back in the dome watching hockey games?
Pretty thrilled.
I was I got a little, well, obviously because I was high as a kite too, but I got a little emotional.
Did you cry?
I had to sit down and just like drink it all. And I was like, man, this is so nice to be back. I had a beer I love watching hockey. It was just, the boys were buzzing. It was awesome.
You don't realize it's such a standard part of your upbringing, standard part of our lives. Sporting was live sporting events and things like that. It was the CBS commercial that they did before the PBR came back last year. They did a spot where they were visiting like domes and buildings and just iconic sporting venues all over the place, mainly America, but like everything down to a slow pan through an empty Indianapolis and stuff. And it did like a whole, you know, this is important right now and moves over to families being at home and being together and things like that. When all the COVID-y things were really at the height. And I will admit to you, that commercial made me tear up because it just made you realize how much that outlet, how much a sporting outlet. We can stand here and scream at each other about, you know, riders, stamps and stuff, but it's part of what makes life interesting and things like that to look at. So I can vouch for being a little emotional getting back.
Oh man, it was great. Looking forward to hitting a few games this winter for sure. Who are you most excited to see play in real life, Ted?
Who, me?
That you haven't seen play before.
Oh, to actually see play. I don't think I've seen Crosby play yet. I don't know.
That's a treat. That's like one of the, I've seen him play twice now. Oh, it's so fun to watch. He's amazing.
Yeah. And like,
he may not be back in the lineup though for the game
Kucherov.
Here.
Oh, really? I'm excited to see some of those big dogs. I don't even know if I've seen, I think I've seen Price play too, but hopefully like through our friends, Dustin and Allie, the trails is maybe we'll get to meet Price. Carey.
I wouldn't be bad.
Maybe he'll be on the show by then. Who knows?
We'd love that.
You got to get the trails in order and bring me some
Price in. I'm looking most forward to seeing Kirill Kaprizov.
Oh, Minnesota.
Yeah. He's an electric player. And it's cool to see Minnesota have a little bit of life. So,
you know who stood out to me a lot one time when I was at the Dome was Jack Eichel. That guy was impressively
good. He's smooth, hey?
One time when I saw him at the Dome. Yeah. He was impressive. Like, he stood out. That was one of the first times I remember somebody standing out when I was at the Dome. And then obviously McDavid.
The first time I saw Connor McDavid play was remarkable. I remember It had been, I think it was after his rookie year or right in his rookie year.
Yeah.
But he picked up the puck like in Edmonton zone. And I think he like skated like so fast past Dennis Wideman that it just was like Dennis Wideman looked like a beer league player in the NHL. And McDavid just like cheat coded around him and scored. It was amazing to watch.
Did you know that McDavid is the longest serving captain in Oilers history now?
Really?
Yeah.
That's unfortunate.
Been that long, hey? I think the Oilers are going to be really good this year.
I hope so, because they're about damn time. I think Hyman's going to be money, though.
Hyman and PRV are going to have heck of a season.
Yeah, so is Tyson Berry. And I'm curious to see what Duncan Keith does. That one's kind of a bit of a wild card.
The one thing about Duncan Keith that people don't really give enough credit for is he keeps himself in really good shape. So,
Did you guys see the glass ceiling that was broken in the WHL here recently?
No.
My ignorance, I don't know the name or her name anymore, but the first female referee.
In the OHL. There's one in the O too.
Oh,
there's more like, they're trying to get in. They talked about it on Spit and Chicklets. They're trying to get more female referees. I think they said they'll probably see one in the AHL this year too.
What do you think the time frame would be on seeing one in the dub or in the Chell?
In the PBR?
I bet you in the next 2 years we see an NHL. Like a linesman, woman linesman.
I think it's badass.
It's not far off because they had an NFL game with like an all female, like referee. I think it was might have been a preseason game. I can't remember.
That's cool. I don't see why there's any sort of gender role in officiating.
Is there space for a lady to play in the NHL, or is it just too much difference?
I don't know. I think that the women that are playing are skilled enough. Mm-hmm. But I don't know, because there's no, it's different like rules, contact, right? Rules, yeah, the con. I'm sure that they could, but I don't know. There's been a more in like women's hockey is like making a comeback. It's a lot of stuff happening. Like, more attention's being brought to it. So
I think it's more a community and an environment thing, because I got nothing against men and women competing together and against one another. But the NHL is certainly at a level where it's just at that level. And my opinion is that investment needs to come back to the women's sports. You hear that so much that you just don't get that same marketing.
I think there's more value for the women's game for the to have support from the NHL rather than them try to get women into the NHL. Yeah.
100%.
I think there's more value in that.
They got to buy into it.
Yeah. Yeah. But I don't know, man. Time will tell. Crazy times.
Thanks for listening. This has been episode 101 of Cowboy Shit with Ted and Wacey. I'm Ted. He is Wacey. Thanks to our friend Kobe Moore for being on the show and our guest Keith Ryan Cartwright, our editor Sean Morton, Storm Defoe on the graphics and the merchandise, shipping, receiving, organizing.
Chief of operations, basically. COO. Also, don't forget to check our social media, Cowboy Shit Official, most platforms. You can stay up to date what we're doing. TikTok. Our sponsors, Circle 4 Ranch Water, Circle 4 Beverage Company, and our friends at Manscaped. Use code HUGEBUSH to save 20% and free worldwide shipping. Manscaped.com.
At Kobe Moore on Instagram.
Check him out. He's one of the best in the biz for good reason.
He is.
But yeah, we'll catch you next time.
Boys, I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Doesn't matter what anybody says. Anyways, cowboy shit.
My first love was a fearless driving rain. Scared to death, I thought I'd never see her face again. They said God was crying, so I guess he felt my pain. My first love was a fearless driving rain. My first love was a wild, sinful night. I ran out with the big dogs, guess I had more bark than bite. No, I won the battle. In the end, I lost the fight. Yeah, my first love was a wild, sinful night.